Today I would like to explain you some of the work that I've been doing in the last, let's say, 5 or 6 years about how to simulate tensor network with, gauge theory with tensor network. And basically, that's the outline that I would like to show you. Basically, I hope that I will spend around 5 minutes describing gauge theory, and then in particular why we use the lattice to study gauge theory. And then I would really just show you a slide of motivation, because I think that everyone that is in this school already is motivated to use tensor network, so there is not really big need. Then maybe here we'll spend a bit more time, because it is about how robust is gauge symmetry, and what can happen when we have a small perturbation to our system. And this will lead me to these exotic phases of matter. Then I will really spend a few seconds in describing what are tensor networks, because I hope that by the end of this workshop all of you are aware of what they are. And this is these two sections are the one that I would like to spend more time, maybe I will do them on blackboard, because that's really the main idea in the case of Z2 that can then be generalized to an arbitrary group very easily. And if I have time, I will explain you how to generalize it, and I will give some example of results that you can obtain with these techniques. Okay. So hopefully this sounds slightly more than 160 minutes, but I'm happy to skip the parts. At least the last two parts, I can skip them, and maybe I will go fast on the rest. So let's start with gauge theories. So gauge theories, as you are well aware, I hope, are at the basis of our understanding of interaction. So we think that every time we see interaction, at least at high energies, despite the fact that one originally can think of a long-range potential, these are contact interaction mediated by some particle that we call gauge boson. In the case of QED, is a photon. That can be described, at least for QED, in some perturbative way, thinking that there exists a particle isolated from the electron that is called a photon, and it's certainly sure when the coupling constants or the charge of an electron goes to zero. In general, they are kind of related. And we can start to study processes in high energy by assuming that we have to isolate particle, electrons, and photon, and do perturbation theory around the free particle solution. Okay. Then, recently, gauge theory has also appeared in a completely different context, where one study collective emergence. And so it has been observed that some phases of material are naturally described as if there were some kind of emerging theory at low energy, an emerging gauge theory at low energy. And the main difficulty of gauge theory is that, despite the fact that in abelian gauge theory we have a well-controlled small parameters, when you go to an abelian gauge theory, it turns out that the coupling constant increases as you go to lower and lower energy rather than decreasing. And so if you want to describe the low energy physics of a non-abelian gauge theory, you don't have any small parameter to make an expansion, right? And it was the genius of Wilson that had the idea to discretize the space-time and put these theories on a lattice and do computer simulation to extract the physics out of it. So it has become a full field, right? And this is, the seminal paper. So a bit of history. As I told you, we discovered the Coulomb interaction. So Coulomb discovered the Coulomb interaction in the 17th century. It took a lot of time to understand that light was made of particle, and that it's relatively recent, so it's only 100 years, no? And as I told you, the fact that there is this small number, no, the fine this alpha, no, the fine structure constant, it allows us to perform perturbative calculation in this theory, and they are very precise. Nevertheless, there are other processes like this four fermion scattering process, where we have seen appearing other gauge bosons. So if you zoom if you zoom enough, so this looks like a contact process, but if you zoom enough, you see that there is some particle flying in between these constituent here, and they were actually observed in the 70s at CERN. And so here it was the first, if you want, observation of non-abelian gauge bosons. So the fact that the structure, the mathematical structure of electrodynamics can be generalized to other groups. And so then after, you know, in the 70s, this was kind of a niche community that were doing gauge theories. Everyone was doing this kind of string, Veneziano string, where you could interpret the appearance of these particles as a specific resonance state of strings. But then they started to discover more and more resonances in accelerator, and everything fit with the fact that there was some symmetry. So these are organized as a kind of a multiplet of a given symmetry. No? And so the interesting thing is that in order to describe this multiplet, you have to assume that there are some elementary constituents that are called quarks, and we still haven't seen free, right? We have seen them in a high energy, deep in the lattice scattering experiment, where we see clearly the presence of three constituents that Feynman originally called partons, but there is no way to separate this object, at least maybe now there is in this quark gluon plasma. And so the idea is that we would like to have a machinery where you input some very high energy, you input some theory that is based on the symmetry principle, on this gauge invariance that I will tell you more about what it is. And then we have a machinery, maybe the lattice and the computer, that will spit you at very low energy the emerging low energy degrees of freedom. And it will allow you to go from this theory of quarks, if you want, and gluons, to what we see as the stable resonances in nature that are meson hadron. Okay? So that's a bit the motivation. And now, as I told you, until now, the best possible tool that we had was lattice QCD. And so the idea was due to, as I told you, Wilson, basically, instead of having photons, you describe small Wilson lines that are kind of small string with a beginning and a end, and they are described on a lattice. And it turns out that this beginning and end describe some Hilbert space, but not all the state are allowed. There is some selection, that is what gauge symmetry asks you, and so you have to restrict somehow your Hilbert space to this subsector. And this is basically all the idea. And now you can write the, yes?
So why is this described as a string? What's the motivation for this?
Maybe, I hope it will be clear by the end of the talk. But these are basically extended objects that have an end, a beginning and an end. Because geometrically they are connection, so between two different spaces. But I hope it will become clearer as we go. And so, if you now follow all the formalism and recipes and you write the things on the lattice, it turns out that you can get the evidence of the absence of free quark in a pure gauge theory, and you can also extract all the masses that we observe. So these blue dots are the input from the experiment, so you have some free parameter in your, if you want, Hamiltonian or Lagrangian, that you feed fixed by kind of inputting the experimental value of these masses, but all the red dots are experimental numerical data that you extract from your simulation that coincide precisely with what we measure in experiments. So this is really impressive, and you see you can also compute scattering processes and things like that, and you see that the data from Monte Carlo, depending on the algorithm and on the group, slightly differ, but they are more or less all compatible with what they use to compute then the scattering, so the scattering element in high energy accelerators for describing the phenomenology of high energy processes. Nevertheless, there are still a lot of things that we cannot compute in lattice QCD, and one of them is the phase diagram of the nuclear matter. If you want, if you think of these gluons and quarks like electrons and photons, and you put them together, you can construct
the various nuclear atoms, no, or atoms, if you want. And we still don't understand well the phase diagram. Basically, we do understand the phase diagram at zero fermion density on this line, but we cannot move in this direction, and this is the same reason that Philip discussed in his lecture, that there is this sign problem in Monte Carlo, and so all these red lines are conjectural or are based on phenomenological models that don't come from first principle, right? So maybe they are correct, but we cannot test them from first principle. And there are several experiments that have to do with stars and with cold gluon plasma that exactly explore this region of the phase diagram, and so we would like to know more about this. And the other thing is that most of the experiments are out of equilibrium situations, so you smash big, for example, big ions, heavy ions one against the other, and you produce a large energy density, and we even don't know how to theoretically describe these out-of-equilibrium processes, right? There are some model like the functional renormalization group, but they are not really kind of backed by calculation from first principles one more. And so we have some intuition of what's going on. We believe that here we can observe free quarks, for example, at these very high energy densities, but we still miss the tool to perform the calculation from first principle. And then there is, a more theoretical part of it, that is the, if you want, the absence of a good theory of classifying phases beyond the Landau paradigm of phase transition, that is also strongly related with gauge theory, because these phases exactly occur in this type of systems. So this is a bit the motivation. And now I will fastly go into the why I think that tensor network is a good thing. First of all, we can study frustrated and fermionic system, as we heard in previous talk. Then we can perform auto-equilibrium dynamics, at least in some very specific scenario, one-dimensional and short times, but hopefully we will extend this. And the third thing is there is a big field of classifying exotic phases and topological phases that also we heard in this group. So I think that from this perspective, tensor network provide a natural framework to address questions that naturally arise in gauge theories. And so I would like to stop one second and before going into the technical details, discuss what happened to symmetry and superposition when you have a global symmetry and when you have a local symmetry. So, and this is related with the why we don't see macroscopic superposition in nature. So we all know that the spin is a quantum object that can be up or down or in an arbitrary superposition. But if we look at our cat, it cannot be dead or alive or in arbitrary superposition, right? And the idea is that there is something going on when you scale the size of the system. And that's what I wanted to try to explain. It is clearly the spontaneous symmetry breaking. And so imagine that you have, for example, a chain of spin 1/2 system. You can define a symmetry operator that would flip your spins from up to down. And you can describe two Hamiltonians for the system, whose ground state will be, if you want, the equilibrium state of a macroscopic system. One of them is, if you want, unfrustrated with the symmetry, and it brings you to a product state. So the ground state of this Hamiltonian would be all the spin pointing in each of them in a position of up or down, but uncorrelated. So what is it? And the other one is this Hamiltonian here, that it's not frustrated because it commutes with G, but it's locally frustrated, so it doesn't commute on a single site. Right, and so the ground state of this Hamiltonian here is exactly the Schrödinger cat. No, it's all spin up plus all spin down, and the question is why don't we observe that state? And so I wanted to discuss it with you at the blackboard because I think it's a nice exercise. So first of all, how many of you are aware of the details of the things? Because if everyone is aware, I can skip it.
What?
Of the difference between spontaneous symmetry breaking with local and global symmetry. Okay, then I briefly state. So here we have global symmetries. And here we have local symmetries. So the presence of a symmetry allows, if you want to have the situation in which you have an Hamiltonian that commutes with the symmetry operator, so H is the Hamiltonian, G is the symmetry operator, in both cases, but it turns out that in this case here, the symmetry operator is somehow localized on a region. So where S maybe is a site of a lattice. Okay, so you have always to think the standard scenario is that we have a lattice. And so if you want, S is some support around the site of the lattice. Whether here this G really acts on all my lattice, okay? And it turns out that if this happens, you can have two situations. Either the if you want, your ground state is invariant under the symmetry, and then it can even be unique, right? Or your ground state is degenerate, no? And so, and the symmetry kind of move inside the ground state subspace.
Or you not. Assume that your symmetry is factorizable in local
yes.
ones?
See, yes. So I'm assuming that the global symmetry is, for example, in the form of a product over I of, for example, sigma xi, okay? And the local one would be a subset of this, so product over, let's say, i1, i2, i3, i4. So it would be these four. So maybe let's call it s1, s2, s3, s4. Sigma x, s1, sigma x, s2, and so on. Okay, so here is product of all, and here is product of only four. And now the question is, imagine that you have, imagine that, so in order to be, if you want, in order to be concrete, let's take a very specific example. And here we are interested in getting some superposition, so we take as Hamiltonian the sum over I, sigma z I, sigma z I plus one. Okay, so this commutes with this, okay, and it turns out, as we said, that it has a ground state degenerate space, so omega 1 is just up tensor n, omega 2 is just down tensor n. Okay, so you see, the only things that matters for the Hamiltonian is that these two states, the spins are aligned, but then it turns out that G moves omega 1 into omega 2, right? So I could decide, since these two operators commute, I could decide to simultaneously diagonalize them, and I would obtain, if you want, an omega symmetric, no? That is the sum of omega 1 plus omega 2, and an omega, if you want, odd, no? Or anti-symmetric, that is the difference. Okay, and so this we could get this macroscopic superposition, and the question is how stable it is, right? What does it mean how stable it is? It means what happens if I add some perturbation to my Hamiltonian. So first of all, we would like to obtain this superposition, and you can convince yourself with a simple exercise. This, if I put what is called a transverse field, so if I put a sum over I sigma xi on every site, then these are indeed the two ground states, and they're splitting, so this is a perturbation, so it lifts the degeneracy, but it exactly lifts the degeneracy in these bases here, and the splitting between these two goes like epsilon t to the L, where L is the number of sites, okay? So you have two ground state that now are split, if you want. We have this, this is L, this is log of the gap, okay? So this is minus 1, I don't know, minus 2. So you have to think this is 10 to the minus 1, 10 to the minus 2, and so on, okay? And so what you see is that as you increase the size of your system, these gaps goes down, okay? And this is very important. So these two states are getting more and more close to each other. And now we want to know, so maybe I raise this upper part here. Okay, so we want to know what happened if I add, so if my symmetry breaks, what does it mean? That I either all spin up or all spin down, right? And so I can define an operator that is the magnetization, that is the sum over I sigma z, sigma z I, and I can just add it here, plus h m, and then the expectation value of this operator, so I would like to compute the expectation value on the ground state, so the expectation value of m would just be equal to the derivative with respect to h of this h that now depends on h at h equal to 0. Is it clear? So I add it to the Hamiltonian, take the derivative at h equal to 0, and I get exactly the expectation value of this operator. No, because this is exactly
of the derivative. Huh? We're looking at an
no, because that's exactly okay. I will think about it, but no, for me. Anyway, so it turns out that if you look at so now the system at any finite epsilon and L is not degenerate anymore, so I can just check what is the expectation value of the magnetization in the ground state, right? This is the first order perturbation theory. Since I want to do the derivative, that's only all what I need, right? And if I would do so, I would see that the expectation value of the magnetization is zero, because this is a symmetric state, so the magnetization, so I can act, as I say, this is the symmetric state, so if I act with G, that would flip omega 1 into omega 2, I would get back the same state, meaning that the magnetization is zero, okay? Because this, if you have a symmetric state, it's zero. On the other hand, if you plot here now H, at any fixed H, and you do the thermodynamic limit, you would see that at some point, the gap between these two states here is smaller than H, okay? And it turns out that this means that that calculation is wrong, because I want to take the thermodynamic limit, and I need to go back to the degenerate subspace and consider now that my relevant perturbation is M rather than the transverse field. For a sufficiently big system, this will always be the case. And so if I do that, and I consider that M is my relevant perturbation, the relevant state that I have to pick up is this one, okay? And then I will do the first order perturbation theory with respect to now epsilon to this transverse field, and now I would get some. So I would get that this has energy now, whatever it would have energy n plus h, small h n. So this is my energy without perturbation theory plus some order epsilon t square. Okay, that comes from now this piece here as perturbation. And now it turns out that if I do the derivative of this stuff here, I get exactly what I expect, that I have a finite magnetization in the limit that h goes to zero. So what's happening is that this is what is called the thin spectrum, becomes thinner and thinner and thinner. At some point, I really have to change my diagonalization basis, go to this basis here. And in this basis here, it turns out that I have finite magnetization, meaning that I have spontaneous symmetry breaking. And meaning that whatever small h I will have here, if I'm not able to protect my system by, so if there is no kind of physical mechanism that avoid the presence of any as small as you want h, you will always end up in the thermodynamic limit with this state under the superposition. Okay, so there is no, if you want Hamiltonian, that in the thermodynamic limit is stable against this. This kind of perturbation. Now I want to repeat the same argument, but in the case of a local symmetry. So is it clear? So that's why we cannot see the cat, rather the life, I guess, because life is a discrete symmetry, right? It's either zero or one. And so Now I wanted to repeat the same reasoning for the local symmetry. First of all, let's define an Hamiltonian, H, that is defined on four sides this time, still local, but four term, that is sigma z, let's say p1, sigma z p2, sigma z p3, sigma z p4, we're in two dimensions, so I call the plaquette of my lattice p, okay, and maybe this is p1, this is p2, this is p3, and p4. And now I put the degrees of freedom on the links, but it doesn't really matter, right? You can just rotate the lattice. But anyway, that's the thing. And first of all, let's study the ground state of this object, and we see that it's highly degenerate, because now if I, so if I, let me see, if I define with the black line the state 0, and with the red line the state 1, so we know that sigma z on 0 is sigma z is 0, sorry, and sigma z on 1 is minus 1. Okay? So now we can ask ourselves, what is the ground state? What are the ground state of this Hamiltonian here? And it turns out that let's consider a single plaquette for simplicity, but you can extend it. Then I miss this one and this one. Okay, and now I complete it. And the important thing is that on a single plaquette, I always have only, probably I have to put a minus in the Hamiltonian. And so let's put a minus here, sorry. So the important thing, so this operator has eigenvalue plus 1 and minus 1, because it's the product of four sigma operators. It turns out that every configuration of my spin, such that in a plaquette I have two spin down, it always gives me the minimal energy, okay? So we have a lot of degeneracy here. And now the question is, can we leave this degeneracy? Well, it turned out that you can do a similar thing. So you can diagonalize simultaneously your Hamiltonian and your symmetry operator. Now the symmetry, I haven't defined it, but the symmetry is now acting on the side of my lattice. So imagine that this is my lattice here. And I have a site here in blue. And so my symmetry is the product of sigma x on all the link entering that site. Okay. And now it turns out that we can diagonalize simultaneously the symmetry operator and all possible symmetry operators. So for example, in a just a single plaquette, what are the symmetry operators that you can allow? So you have four of them, right? These are this one, and so on, okay? All the corner, if you want, this one and this one. So you have four symmetry operator. And so we can diagonalize simultaneously the Hamiltonian and the symmetry operator, and we discover that the ground state is the equal superposition of all these degenerate state, okay? And that you can convince yourself, again, I don't do the calculation, but you can do it as an exercise, that the same stuff happens if I add, again, my epsilon transverse, sum over link, let's say this time, because the constituents are on the link, of my transverse field, that is sigma x on the link, okay? So it turns out that if you add this small perturbation, again, the degeneracy is lifted, and the real ground state, that is, again, an energy epsilon squared transverse, it has an energy epsilon squared transverse with respect to the other state, will be the equal superposition of all these things. And here we start to see a big difference, because if you remember here, so the splitting in the global symmetry case would depend on the system size. So we would have this thin spectrum that will get thinner and thinner and thinner and thinner and thinner. But here we see that you have a splitting that is independent on the system size. That's a very big difference, okay? Because now if we repeat the exercise that we did before, and we just add a small h sigma z, sum over L sigma z L, that is my magnetization, okay? Now it turns out that you can convince yourself that since if we repeat this graph here, now this would be the gap, and the gap as a function of L is constant, okay? So it's again log of the gap and logarithmic k. This may be 10 to the minus 2, I don't know, whatever you want, depending on epsilon, right? But the gap is now constant, and so since I have to take the limit h going to 0 to compute the magnetization in this formula here, okay? Turns out that if this gap is constant, I can clearly compute the magnetization onto the ground state, that is an equal superposition, and since each of these states has a two-symmetric partner here, the magnetization cancels. Okay, so this linear superposition contains both plus m and minus m, where m is an arbitrary number between minus 4 and 0. And so doing the sum, this stuff cancels, and we don't have any symmetry breaking. Okay, so that's why if we have a gauge theory, we can have large superposition, no, like a cut state. Unfortunately, it's not the same type of superposition, because in a cut state, there is correlation, so long-range correlation. If I know that one spin is up, I know that the n spin is also up. But in this state here, there is no correlation. So there is entanglement that is called long-range entanglement without any correlation, no, in this kind of state. This is an example of a topological phase. But that is exactly why gauge theory are interesting. Because as I told you, one would expect that if you have a big system and you cool it down sufficiently, and you have a discrete symmetry, you would always break the symmetry. And so at some point, you have a kind of Curie transition, where we have observed material in which this phenomenon doesn't happen, right? And then the only theoretical framework we have to discuss the appearance of the absence of spontaneous symmetry breaking is exactly in the case of discrete symmetry, is exactly the gauge theoretical framework. So that's what I wanted to motivate. So this is another reason why it's interesting to study gauge theories. And I go back. So how am I going with my schedule? It's okay, no? Yes. Should I do something?
Are you basically saying that all theories of matter that we have are all topological theories? Like all the high energy particle physics theories?
No, because it depends on the phase. So I show you a very specific phase that is what is called the strong coupling phase of gauge theory. And then there are phase transitions. And depending on the group, depending on if the group is continuum or discrete.
Right, because here we, for example, looked at the ferromagnetic side, but you could also look at the one where even in the...
So you can, for example, increase these...
In the non-perturbed version, you have a unique ground state, and then this thing...
The point is that... So what I mean is that here you have already one parameter, right? If you send this to infinity, this is basically irrelevant, and you immediately see that you have a ground state in the x direction. That's a trivial state. And it's what you would call a confined phase in the lattice gauge theory language. Okay? So the confined phase are topological phase, and confined phase are typically... phases from the point of view. But probably there is more to that. So, as I told you, our classification of phases goes back to Landau, and we have the first example of a system that shows a phase transition. I didn't tell you that there is phase transition, but it's clear, right? If I now increase this epsilon, I go to a ground state that is a product state rather than this robust superposition. And in both sides, the symmetry is exactly the same, okay? So it's not a symmetry breaking transition. And so this was observed in the, as far as I know, that's the first reference of it, but maybe there are others that I am not aware of. So this is a journal of mathematical physics of the 70s. And again, there is this phase transition between a topological and a trivial state. And why is it relevant? Because a lot of people have thought about this stuff, and basically Anderson has proposed this resonating valence bond picture in which you have an Heisenberg antiferromagnet on a sufficiently frustrated lattice, and now you could describe the ground state as a spin zero sector, and it turns out that you can decompose it in the singlet basis, and it turns out that you can think of it as a superposition of singlet in various places, and if you sum over the superposition, you don't break any symmetry. Okay? And so this is the spin liquid thing. And now that I have motivated the relevance of gauge theory in several fields, I would like to go to how do you study them with tensor network. Okay? So notation, we know that balls are tensor and lines are indices, so vectors, matrices, you can multiply matrices by joining two lines. Take the trace of the product of two matrices. Okay. The reason is that we have large Hilbert spaces, and in general complicated objects. They want to decompose into simpler one, because these complicated objects have too many coefficients, and so we cannot even store them. Right. And clearly, the idea is that you go to your shop, you buy your Lego blocks, and then you assemble whatever you want. Right. It turns out that if you're lucky enough, these things look like a building, despite the fact that it's not really a building. And so these things look like a wave function, and a relevant wave function, despite the fact that it's not really what it is. And so all the business of doing tensor network for lattice gauge theory is to design this very non-abelian Lego stuff, where you have very specified pieces, that you assemble them together, and you attain very specific stuff. No? And in particular, you can think of the Hilbert space like a big box. And it turns out that the state you are interested in are only those states that are left invariant by this local symmetry operator that I described above, what we call physical Hilbert space. And you would like to just target them in some. So we saw that it's not strictly necessary because we expect each symmetry to be robust. But from a computational point of view, it's probably the best thing you can do because it's become cheaper. Right. So what do tensor networks describe? As I told you, they don't describe everything, but you have this ball that is your Hilbert space, and as you increase the bond dimension of your elementary tensor, we hope that we could, in principle, explore all the Hilbert space. Interestingly, this small region that we describe with tensor network is relevant to the ground state of a sufficiently local engapped Hamiltonian, and we can try to extend it to also non-engapped Hamiltonian in some cases with extra symmetry. And then I go to constructing theory for lattice gauge theory. This should be the core of this lecture, so yes, I think that I should be done in 40 minutes, more or less, even less if I'm lucky. And I switch again back to Blackboard. So maybe I have an outline. So this is the things that I want to describe with you. So I go back here. Is it clear up to now?
Which code do you write to write your lecture? You can use a blackboard, true blackboard.
Do you prefer to use? Maybe I can just move this. Is it? Can you see?
We can.
Okay. So let's start with the group. Okay. Hopefully, every one of you knows what the group is. But I will just review the very basic stuff. And I will do it on maybe two specific examples so that we have something to deal with. And so ideally, the group is something where you can multiply elements and get back another element of the group. Right? So there are some elements. There is a notion of multiplication, and there is a notion of closure under multiplication. And then if the multiplication commutes, it's an abelian group. If the element commutes, if not, it's a non-abelian group. But let's stay concrete and take our group Z2 that has two elements that I call E and G. Okay, and it turns out then you can visualize it as a two-point on the circle, right? Maybe we typically put the origin here, so let's put one and into the I pi. And so E would be 1, E to the I pi would be G in some representation. And it turns out that I have the following. So I can, as I told you, I can multiply the elements. Okay. So I write here E, and I write here G, and here I write again E, and I write G. And now I can multiply them. And it turns out that E times E gives me E, E times G gives me G, because so E times G gives me G, because E is my identity element, so it doesn't do anything, so we also always have to have an identity element. And then, again, G times E is abelian is again G, and G times G, that's the main thing, gives E. Okay, so it's the square of the only non-trivial element gives me back the identity. Okay, this is the group multiplication table. That's the basic object you would start with. And now from this group multiplication table, you can find matrix representation of your group. So we will use a matrix acting on some Hilbert space to encode this multiplication table. And in particular, we can define what is called the group algebra. That is an Hilbert space whose element are the element of the group. So in this case, it has two states. No? So it has a state that we call E and a state that we call G. Okay, and I can take linear combination of these states. But the question is, how do I act? So how do I represent this group on this Hilbert space? No? And this is a very simple recipe. It gives you what is called the fundamental. The regular representation of your group that is just so if you want to know what is the matrix, so we will call R of E, the matrix that implements the rotation of the element E in my Hilbert space, right? And so here I put F because it's a representation. No? I have chosen a two-dimensional vector space, right? And so it turns out that I take my multiplication table and I replace where I see E, I put a 1, and where I don't see E, I put a 0, I get, surprise, surprise, the identity matrix, right? So the identity, as we expect, is represented by the identity. But now if I take RF of G, I get sigma x. Okay? So the rotation for the non-trivial element in this space here is represented by sigma x. And you can check that RF of G on state 0, that would be my E, is equal to 1, right? And so on. So this really flips your spin if you want, okay? Now, it turns out that there is a concept that is called reducibility of a representation. So it turns out that you may be interested in the smallest possible Hilbert space on which you can define still the action of your group, right? And the smallest possible Hilbert space is always of dimension 1, because if you have a table of multiplication and you put 1 everywhere, it's always fulfilled, right? 1 to arbitrary powers. So if you identify all group elements with 1, it's not very useful, but it works, right? So everything is fulfilled. This table here is fulfilled, not if I put 1 everywhere. And so the question is, what is the other possible smallest dimension of my Hilbert space that allows me to describe my group? And one way to obtain it is to start from your multiplication table and try. So turns out that these two matrices commute as you expect because you have an abelian group, and so we can diagonalize them, right? And if I diagonalize these matrices, So I go to, maybe for the moment I don't talk about U1. I go to a new basis. Really, the only one that I have to diagonalize is this one, because this is diagonal in any basis, right? As we all know, sigma z, sigma x in the diagonal basis look like sigma z. And this is what I call, if you want, electric basis. And I hope it will become clearer later. Okay? And I, in order to know in which basis I'm working, I will use, instead of 0 and 1 that I used in the group algebra, here I will use plus and minus. Okay, so the basis, the electric basis will be denoted by plus and minus, and the group algebra will be denoted by 0 and 1. Okay, up to now all is clear, so now at this stage I have in the electric, so let's say Re in our case of E is equal again to 1, 0, 0, 1, and Re of G is equal to 1, 0, 0, minus 1. And then you immediately see that in this representation, we can see that we now have decomposed my original representation to the direct sum of two blocks. Okay, the first block is the first is the plus plus, the projector to the plus plus state, and you see that in this is exactly the trivial representation we were talking about, where both E and G are represented with the number plus one. Okay, and the second block is this here, where G and E are represented by what we expect, 1 and minus 1. This was what I was picturing here. Okay, so we have gone to the regular representation to the direct sum of irreducible representation. And I hope that I will be able to explain you a theorem that relates the two. But for the moment, let's stick. So bear in mind that there is a theorem called the great orthogonality theorem in the theory of group representation that allows you to do it in a very general way. Okay, yes.
Is that so when you construct a regular representation for any group that's basically always has the size of a multiplication table and it's only filled with ones and zeros?
Yes. Yes. Clearly here we are talking about discrete groups, right? Okay, now I will erase, okay? We need a notion of what I call symmetric entangler and disentangler. That probably is not the stuff that a group theorist will. It is this one, no? We call, but that's how I call it. And this is really the basic of all what we will do from now on. So just maybe I remind you that 0, 1 is the group algebra, so C of G, and plus and minus, or yes, plus and minus, is the what I call the electric basis, that is the direct sum of all the reducible representation. Okay, so this is what keep in mind. And now I go back to my group algebra, and I define what I call symmetric entangler or disentangler, that is just so in probably in the group language they would call it projector to the trivial representation of some specific thing, but I don't care, and I call it U equal to the sum over G over G G tensor R, and here so let's put U R. Okay, so that's the definition. Clearly it acts on the tensor product of two Hilbert space. This is the group algebra, And this is the R irreducible, R rep, that could be sum of several irreducible representations, could be just one irreducible representation, so you have freedom to choose. Okay? So that's the definition. Let's see how it looks like in our Z2 case. Okay? So let's go to our first case, in which I take as a R, as a irreducible representation, I take the minus, okay? The irreducible representation minus, where I remind you that the minus was that representation in which the element, the non-trivial element is mapped to minus one, okay? So it's just numbers. And so if I write this, I get that my U, minus, is equal to 0, 0, tensor 1, now this is a number, okay, plus 1, 1, tensor minus 1, okay? What is this? Again? Well, you missed a beer. This is sigma z. Okay? That's sigma z, okay? So my symmetric entangler, where I choose here this minus representation, is just sigma z. Now what happens if I choose the symmetric entanglement, the symmetric entangler in the regular representation now? There was this group algebra, okay? So I get 0, 0. Now the representation here is the identity 2 by 2, no? Plus 1, 1, and here is sigma x. What is this? Anyone knows? That's called the C0 gate. Okay? That's something very important in the quantum computation. And so that's the same object, no? I just wanted to point out that that's the same object, just in different representation. Now we can ask, what does this C0 gate look like if I change? So if I, instead of working on the fundamental representation, in the regular representation, I rotate the basis to the direct sum of irreducible representation. So I take these two together.
Can you say again why we are even doing this? Why are we considering a tensor product of these two guys?
I will get to that. So for the moment, I define the objects, and now I hope that little by little it becomes clear why.
So okay, now. There you constructed this in different representations. The one case, the representation was one-dimensional. In the second case, it's all of a sudden two-dimensional.
Yes, because it's the regular representation, the starting one,
yeah,
right?
Okay.
And so that's the representation. If you remember, that the matrix...
That was okay, so you're doing it in Europe and in a reproducible one.
Yes.
Just for fun.
For the moment, just for fun. And I hope you will see what's the use of it then, okay? So I have this thing, and what I wanted to tell you, so you can do the exercise, if I now change the basis to the direct sum of plus, plus, minus, what you will get is that here, so I change now the basis on this side, on the left, okay? So here, instead of getting 0, 0, plus 1, 1, I will get something that is plus, minus, tensor, the projector on plus, plus, minus, plus, I'm wrong, so it's, I get, I can do the same thing, and now, basically, I get the identity, tensor, the projector onto the plus, irrep plus the sigma x tensor the projector onto the minus state. Okay. You can just do the exercise. You apply this W that we defined before, and you get this other expression. But I mean, it's not really important, just to show you that the form of this object depends on the basis you choose, but it is a very well-defined algebraic object that is important in the following.
What do you choose for the last line? Because it's not the bra cat and bra anymore.
Well, it's not the cat and bra because now we have 0, 0 plus 1, 1, right? That is the identity. And this is 0, 1 plus 1, 0. I mean, this was a very sparse stuff where I only had one element, so I wrote it like that. But I could have put it in like P on 0 and P on 1. Okay, that's what I've written here.
But that's how you find it in the first place. Because you have a tensor product on different space, so your P would be a
So P here would be, so P on, so the projector is always P on 0 would be 0, 0, and P on 1 is 1, 1, okay? Yes. And here P on plus and P on minus is the projector onto plus plus and the projector onto minus minus in a different basis. So plus and 0 and plus are related by a change of basis. But the important thing is that I have some freedom of choosing both the basis on which I work, that could be the direct sum of irreducible representation, no, and the target space of my R. No? So here I have two freedom. One is the basis that I work with.
When you transform from the second to the third line, do you have to transform on both the representation and the...
So it turns out that you can only transform, you can only transform this. And you will, if you do the calculation, you would see that it comes out here, the projector onto the plus space. But I mean, it's an exercise. We can maybe do it later together. Just, the important thing is that you have this formula. Okay, you understand? So you understand what this formula means and how to build this object in a specific choice of representation and group. Okay. So maybe forget, if you forget about this last line, if it creates confusion, it's not very important. I hope that these two should be, you should understand them, right? So again, you are constructing an object that acts on the tensor product of two Hilbert space. You can decide what is the Hilbert space here, and is given by this label here, okay? And the important thing is that you build it like this, so that on this side you have the group algebra, you take the sum over all the possible group elements, and somehow you read the group elements here and rotate by the corresponding matrix. That's a bit the intuition of it. That's a, I mean, it's a simple, if you want, it's a simple, in tensor network notation, it's a simple four body operators, no? Where here you have CG, and here you have CG, and here you have your VR, VR, no? Depending on this R here, okay? And it turns out that this is a very specific structure, is a sum of different pieces. Each of them is diagonal on this leg here in the correct basis, right? If you work on the group algebra, it's diagonal. And here, it performs different stuff. So if you want, this is just something like, exactly, I would write the same stuff, no? So, GG tensor RG sum over G. Okay, so that's the structure of this tensor, there. Is it clear? No. Okay, so I can erase everything. Please remember this. And now I hope it becomes clear why this object is relevant. Because we now go to constructing. So now we take a lattice. So all what we need for group theory is now known. And I take a lattice and I construct a local Hamiltonian. So my spin degrees of freedom will be on the link of my lattice. That's it, okay. on the link of my lattice, here I have C, in this case, let's say we have a spin 1 half, C2, okay? And I want to define, first of all, the concept of local symmetry. So I have S1, so this C2 we said is the regular representation of my group, so it makes complete sense saying that here I have G1, G2, G3, and G4, or if you want in bracket notation G1, G2, G3, and G4. I orient the lattice even if in the Z2 case is completely useless, but because G to the minus 1 is G, okay? But it doesn't matter. So I orient my lattice and I define a local symmetry operator, so a rotation by some element of my group, H, that send me these states into, and remember that in this case the order and the plus or minus 1 and the power is the same because g to the minus 1 is g, 1 to the minus 1 is 1, okay, so it doesn't really matter, but in general, let me write the generic expression. G1, hg2, hg3, h minus 1, g4. Okay, so this is a local rotation in my group. I have rotated all the links entering a site by a group element that I have chosen, okay? And how do I do this in the specific case of Z2? I just apply, so my G that acts on site S, so this would be the vector around S, 1, 2, 3, and 4. G on site S is just the product of sigma X on these four, you know, of let's say 1, sigma X 2, sigma X 3, sigma X 4, if I'm interested in rotating by the element G. Okay? Yes?
Sorry, can you say again where the difference comes from once you take the to the minus 1 and once you write it to the left and to the right? Okay, it's big and it doesn't matter, but you wrote it in different places, yes. So maybe there's a meaning to it.
The difference is, as you see, if you have a site, the link can enter or exit that site.
Okay, so you put the direction
in the right. If the link enters, you put it on the right, because this would be attached here to your site. If the link exits, you put it on the left. And then if you put H or H minus 1, it depends on the orientation, right? So you can choose if you put H minus 1 on the left and H on the right. The important thing is that you are consistent. So when the link enters, you put it on the right, either to the minus 1 or not to the minus 1. And when the link exits, you put it to the left, either to so the opposite one. Okay? So that's the idea. But the important thing is that in the abelian case, in the Z2 case, these are all equivalent.
And you always have like an equal number of entering and exiting arrows?
Not necessary, no. You can have a triangular lattice, and then there is no way, no. You can choose whatever. But important that the convention is consistent.
Yeah.
Okay.
But here, one of them needs to be on the right.
G4 should be on the right.
And? Sorry.
G4 H minus 1.
One of the H's should be
yes.
On the right.
Sorry. Yeah, right. Yes. Okay, and as I told you, right, this would be in the group algebra, okay, this is the definition of the rotation by the only non-trivial element, because clearly I can define a G S of E, that is the identity, that is just the identity, right, so it doesn't do anything, so I'm not really interested in this operator, but I'm interested in this one. Okay, and then I could go to a different basis, as I told you before, I could go to the electric basis, and now this G would just become product of sigma Z, okay, as we said before, so, and this stays the same, okay, so it really matters if I'm working the electric basis or on the group algebra for what we will see later, I hope. Okay, now I erase. So let's say we have this symmetry operator that I call G. Now I will call it A. Okay, do you mind? Just for consistency with the literature, I call it A. identity, 4 times 4, sorry, 16 times 16. So maybe I can write here. And now, what happened if I use this hidden tree operator and look for his eigenstate? So if I ask, what are those states of my Hilbert space that obey this constraint here, okay, that are left invariant by my symmetry operator? Okay, so these are symmetric state. And then it turns out, if you look at it again, now the best thing is to go to the electric basis. So we are now in the electric basis. So let me erase you one. Meaning that my rotation of G is equal to sigma z, okay? So in this electric basis, the rotation by the element G is sigma z. And now I look at what happened to the link entering one side. And again, I use this color thing where plus is just equal white line and minus is equal to a red line. And as you can imagine, what happened is that since I want just the and that's it. So since I want just the plus one eigenvectors, I'm left with this state here. No, these are 8 states out of the 14 states that I had originally here. So here I have 2 to the 4 state originally because the tensor product of 4 links. And now if I ask that my state is symmetric under this operator here, I select only these 8 states. Okay? If I do it everywhere, I obtain what is called, so if I do it everywhere, meaning for all S, and in general for all G, okay, because here I only had a non-trivial G, okay, but in general if I have a more complicated group, I could do it for all S and for all G, I obtain what is called the gauge invariant Hilbert space. Okay?
So but your space now is still the group element space.
Yes, for on every link it is, but now I'm selecting a subset. So exactly. So let's maybe write it explicitly, because that's an important concept. So that's an important concept. My Hilbert space originally is C2 tensor M, okay, and in general is the group algebra tensor N, okay. Now I have a set of operator A S of G for every S and for every G, where G is an element in G is an element of G, and S is a point of my lattice. Okay, so it's a site of my lattice, and then I define what I call the HP is equal to the set of all the psi, sorry, such that for all S and G, A S G psi is equal to psi. Okay. So that's the gauge invariant Hilbert space. And that's that in the plot. So if you imagine that your Hilbert space is a box, in that plot that I show you, this is exactly HP. HP doesn't necessarily have a tensor product structure anymore. No? And that's all the challenge, right? We want to describe state that belong to a projection or original Hilbert space and not necessarily live in the tensor product subspace. And that's why tensor networks are very well made for tensor product Hilbert space, and a bit more tricky to describe this projected space. Okay. Now that we have defined the HP, we want to define dynamics on this HP. So we want to define gauge invariant operator. So first of all, we have to study a bit of commutation relation. I hope I'm a bit late, but I hope. Is it clear up to now? So I erase everything, okay? So as I said, we are identifying a subset of my Hilbert space, and I want to define a non-trivial dynamic on this Hilbert space, meaning that I have to define operator that commute with my symmetry constraint. Okay, and if they commute trivially, so I have let's go back to our group algebra. If they commute trivially, remember the AS of G in the group algebra was the product of sigma x. So I can take a sigma x. It commutes, but it commutes trivially, right? So sigma x is a good candidate as an operator that gives me some dynamics on this gauge invariant Hilbert space, because it's co-diagonal with my symmetry constraint. And so one thing that I recalled electric field or electric operator, I don't know, is just sigma x. So some of the links, sigma x of link. Okay? This is a legitimate operator that commutes with the symmetry constraint. And now I will go to something that is more complicated, and this is where this symmetric entangler enters, and I will study what happened to my symmetric entangler. So if you remember, the expression is sum over G tensor representation in a given vector space of my G. Okay, what happens if I rotate my first Hilbert space? So this is a guy that is defined on the tensor product of two vector spaces. Here is CG and it is VR. Okay, what happens if I, and it is CG, what happens if I rotate this on this leg here by a representation matrix of the group? So meaning that here I can think it defined on two legs, I have two legs. What happens if I do something like rotation of G on leg one, U, one, two, of G on leg one, okay? I'm trying to understand the commutation relation of this operator with the rotation on the group algebra, okay? Is it clear? So it turns out, if you do the calculation, it's very easy, and maybe it's worth doing it. So let's put an H here. Sorry. So we said that this was G. Now we rotate by H, meaning that we have H, G times, maybe G, H, it doesn't matter, times, because it's abelian. And then we have rotation by G, okay? So I just rotated the group algebra, meaning that if I rotate the state G by H, I get the state GH. That's exactly what I expect in the group algebra. And now I have this expression here. But now I can define GH equals G prime, okay? Do the very simple algebra, and I get that I get equal sum over G prime, tensor, can you see it here? Tensor R, and then I have G primes times H minus 1. Okay? Is it correct? Because GH is G, yes, no? It's correct. Okay? So you see that that's equal to U 1, 2, now rotated on the right leg by H minus 1. On leg two. Okay? So you see that that's a very specific, this is why I call it symmetric, because it has a very specific rule that if I rotate here and here by some H, this is equal to some rotation here by H. Okay? So you have a very specific algebraic structure that is very interesting. And, yes?
U1 to R to H inverse equal U1 to?
No. Sorry? 1, 2 just means that acts on two qubits, if you want, but it can be different. 1, 2 means this 1, 2.
I see, but equal, what means?
Sum, this is a sum, sorry. Sum over G?
Yeah, I see.
So I'm defining it, no? Sum over G, this is the first, this projector onto G, tensor rotation matrix onto
I want to say about last equal. If we
equal. So it's the equal. Same is the same U1 2. So okay, so this last equal is not correct in the sense that if I now rotate this, so it was this one that is equal. Sorry.
Okay.
This one is equal to this one. Sorry. Is it clear? Sorry. So this one is equal to this one. So it pulls through the rotation. Okay. And now we can use this object to construct a non-trivial operator that commutes with the symmetry constraint. So that's all the reason why I've introduced it. And this is what is called the plaquette operator. Maybe let me erase something. I erase here, okay? And I keep this last expression in a graphical form. So we have seen that we have an object that we can write it clearly. Okay, maybe let's rewrite it once more. So we had U, if you want, R, G, sum over G, tensor R, RG. Okay, so we can write it as a matrix product operator. I hope you are familiar with that. Where we have a diagonal line that is GG, the identity. We have a kind of control thing, and here we apply some rotation matrix RG. Okay, so that's a matrix product operator. No, we have sum of terms. This is the sum of G. Okay, is it okay, or do I need to explain it better? You see, we have an index G here, that's that index here, and then it's a representation matrix, so we have two legs here. And here we have an index G, no? So we need to construct this kind of copy tensor that is the diagonal, but then it passes G here, and it sums, okay?
So that's a three-leg delta, sort of.
Yes, okay, this indeed, sorry. This stuff here is equal, if you want, sum over G, 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 another G. Okay, it's a three-leg delta. Okay, so that's our expression, and now I go here, and on this expression here, now I can rotate by R of H up and down, okay, with a dagger here, and the equivalence of before told me that it's equivalent of putting an R of H minus one here. Okay. Okay, so now it turns out that if I go to my lattice, and this drawing is always a bit challenging, so imagine that I have a closed loop, okay? I put four of my these preferred thing here. Now I have the control thing here, the control thing here, the control thing here, the control thing here. So I constructed a matrix product operator with periodic boundary condition made of foresight, okay? And now it turns out that if these foresight are such that on my lattice they describe a closed loop, a plaquette, okay? Every time I apply my sigma, my operator, my symmetry operator, I would act on two links of this plaquette, okay? But as we saw, acting on two links of this plaquette means that I rotate here, 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 and here, but this makes me appear here just an RG, RH here, and an RH minus one here if you do things properly, and so they cancel. So it basically means that this physical symmetry becomes the gauge symmetry of my matrix product operator. Okay, so I can always redefine this matrix the matrix product operator after the action of the symmetry is the same matrix operator of before. Okay, so that's what is called the plaquette operator, and So it's I define it. So I define it in formula here. It's U equal trace over the second leg of U P1, U P2, U P3. Maybe there are some daggers. In the Z2 case, doesn't matter, but in the, you have to be careful with the orientation of your links, okay? But everything is described in detail in the paper for the genetic case, so you can reconstruct it. And so you see, I've done the trace on the auxiliary leg, so on the on this MPO. So I built out an MPO starting from this U tensor, and it turns out that this is a map from four links to four links, no? Because it's an MPO with periodic boundary condition. And the gauge symmetry of my lattice is transcribed to a gauge invariance in the MPO, and so the MPO is left invariant. Okay, so that's the basic ingredient that we need. And now we are in the position. How much time I have? What time I have to finish in 5 minutes? Okay, so we are in the position to define the let's say the Hamiltonian, the complete Hamiltonian of the system. As we said before, so you can do the exercise and see that if you now choose a very specific representation here, so what I called before the electric representation here, you would get that this is just product of sigma z, as you expect, because this is one-dimensional, the internal leg of your MPO. If you take the regular representation, you get something different. Okay, so that's the standard Hamiltonian, the standard Hamiltonian I wrote before, sigma z p1, sigma z, the one that I used for the example on the p2 and so on, is a specific choice where here you put a one-dimensional projector onto one of the rep in the internal leg. But in general, you can have more generic things, okay?
Any of the two is fine?
Oh, any of the two is fine. You get different theories, okay? In principle, you get different theories, but both are gauge invariant. And the standard one is by putting the projector onto the rep there, into the minus rep. Yes. Okay. So this is exactly taking U on the minus, we say, but in general we can write an Hamiltonian that is more general than this, and as far as I know, it hadn't been described in full generality, but maybe I'm wrong. Minus 1 over g squared, sum over p dp, minus sum over links, sigma x on links. Okay? So this is the generic Hamiltonian in this case. There are other possible terms that you can build out of these U operating in the same things that have not been considered, but they are described in the paper. If you're interested, I have no time to go into that. But it turns out that, so let me see what is really important that I tell you. Maybe the important thing is now how we construct the gauge invariant answer for this kind of thing. No, this is an Hamiltonian. So what I wanted to say you is that you can analytically solve the limit g going to infinity and g going to zero. Okay, when g goes to infinity, the ground state is the product state of link in the plus basis. When g goes to zero, the ground state is the torical wave function. Okay, as we saw, if we take this u minus at least. And it turns out that in between there is a quantum phase transition. How do we describe the state in between? We need some variational approximation and describe the wave function, right, as a contraction of tensor. So there are several ways of doing this. There is one way based on the MIRA that, if you are interested in, you can read in the paper. I will go into the PEPS construction, okay, and in these last 5 minutes. So I erase this. And basically, the answer is very simple. We have our lattice. And now for each link, we have an element, we need two class of tensors. I will do it directly in the most generic case. So we first of all, we want to copy our physical Hilbert space into the auxiliary Hilbert space. So we use this copy tensor that we used before. But now we want to extend it such that, so here, for example, we have G, G, G. And this is and the idea is that, so now, if you want, now I write this stuff on the auxiliary level. Okay, so on the auxiliary level for each site, I will have four of these G entering. Okay, so I will have four sites. And what I need to do is to use, so this is what I call a copy tensor, C. And then at this auxiliary level, I need to do a four-leg. I need to use a four-leg tensor that only select among these two to the four Hilbert space the configuration that obey gauge invariance. Okay, and so this configuration. So here is for example this tensor here is just a tensor that if you apply now U dagger. And there is a rotation for your preferred group element. So just to be consistent with what we said before, RG minus one. This is exactly equal to Z. So this is a Z2 even in this case tensor, okay? And now it turns out that if you're familiar with the theory of tensor network in with global symmetry, you know that this means that this tensor has, so the legs of this tensor are composed by direct sum of sectors, right? So we have a charge. So an arbitrary leg of this tensor is made by a couple of a charge plus a degeneracy part of my charge. No, it's a direct sum of several tensors. No, you can think of it as a direct sum of eight different sectors. No, we have eight sectors, all the possible eight charge configurations that are allowed, and each of them can be an arbitrary tensor with different dimensions. So basically, the Hilbert space on the auxiliary level is something like V0 direct sum V1, okay, where these are two Hilbert space whose dimension is arbitrary. Okay, and this copy tensor equally is a strange tensor that only has three, in this case, two sectors, right? It only has, the indices are again, so the copy tensor, the indices are again C, alpha, beta, gamma. They are again double indices, Q, alpha, Q, etc., etc., Q, In general, it could be Q prime, beta Q prime, but the stuff is exactly that this has only two blocks, the 0, 0, 0 block and the 1, 1, 1 block, okay? So it's a specific, again, symmetric tensor that copies the charge from the physical to the auxiliary level, and then it has a matrix, no, in that specific charge sector 0, 0. And so the wave function of this stuff is obtained by just putting one of these copy tensors each link, and if you want a vertex tensor on each side, and so on. Okay, so this is a variational ansatz that describes only gauge invariant state, and then now you can use your preferred algorithm to obtain some results, and maybe if you give me 2 minutes, I'll show you some results. But that's more or less what I wanted to say. Okay, so yes.
So this whatever representation now, not on the virtual level, but on the dots that you drew in your C, this can be understood as an MPS matrix that has a certain exactly the symmetry that you want.
Yes.
Like you would, if you would, whatever simulate some other quantum system with good quantum numbers like magnetization or something, you would have an MPS that has a similar structure, where your physical states are related to some
but the point is that
symmetry, but this is more general, but what you're actually inputting here in the links is exactly MPS tensors of that form.
Yes, the point is that you see the generic symmetric stuff, you have Q1, Q prime,
right.
And here you have the fusion
Q
of Q1, Q prime, that
yes.
Depending on fusion rule could be something. Here I'm saying that you always have to have QQQ. So it's not really, it could even go, so indeed it could even go, you see, I have, in the case of Z2, I have 0, 0, 0, and 0, 0, and 1, 1, 1, so 1 is even, the other is odd, so they're in two different blocks, if you want. But there are only
that's
two
the
blocks.
Upper half of the C, no, I'm talking about the lower half. The thing that contains the representation.
Here, you mean?
Where you define the C on the left side.
So
now
this was
the
link. This was the link to show you that you acted on the link. So it's like just this. The C is just the copy tensor, if you want, plus degeneracy. No, so it's a copy tensor fattened with the degenerate. So in any so if you want, if you fix Q, no, if you put Q to zero, okay, this is just a matrix.
Sure.
That
is
a chi by chi. No, if you put so it becomes just a matrix here, not necessarily tensor product, but
the guys that you then in your network put on the links with the
is this
lines
one?
Down this one.
Yes, is this
right.
One? No?
So this would be the lower half, if like that you drew with your C. So the U that you had before.
Yes.
The guy that acted on two Hilbert spaces. Your symmetric entangler.
No, I mean.
Now I'm talking about this one now. I'm trying to understand what these MPS guys are here in your ansatz.
So this
is difficult to put a fit in, right?
Yeah.
Sorry?
Well, are they any of the tensors that you wrote down before?
No, because the tensor that I wrote down before was a specific stuff, where here I would have the identity. So the U is a specific example of this C, but where here I have the identity or sigma x, depending if I rotate, here I have a set of variational parameters in general. So the structure, if you want, is the same in some sense. So I have really a three-leg tensor with this structure of indices.
So I think this the kind of path you draw in the link, you have a three-leg tensor.
Yes, this one, no?
Is that the one you draw there or not?
Yes, it's this one that I draw there. So This is the C copy here, so it's the same, right? So I say you can either just construct the projector onto the gauge invariant Hilbert space, and it's just a copy tensor in that case. So if you just want to project onto the gauge invariant Hilbert space, you put instead of a 3 legs delta, you put a 4 legs delta, and you just select the gauge invariant configuration at the virtual level, and this is a projector, so it would get something like this, right? And this is the projector onto the gauge invariant Hilbert space and so on, right? But now if you want an MPS, you can take out this leg, and this would represent the state, the equal superposition of all the gauge invariant Hilbert space. But now if you want to weight this superposition in some given way, you can put weight into this tensor, or you can extend it to this block tensor here, where given a charge configuration, so 0, 0, 0, for example, you have a full matrix here of variational parameter. Is it clear? Well, maybe I have to explain it because this.
This tensor also depends on the size, right?
Yeah, yes, it depends on the size. Yes, you can have non-translational invariants. You can pick up a very specific configuration. So that, indeed, so if you just put numbers, for example, if you just put numbers and do the multiplication, since the number commute, you will always have stuff where you weight equally a large set of configuration when you have exchanged the position of 0 or 1 somewhere, but if you have the same number of 0 and 1, you will get the same weight in your configuration. Now, if you put matrices, this is not abelian anymore, and so you can have different weight for different configuration. That's a bit the message, right?
The variational parameters are really in the guy sitting on the links now.
They are both here and here. So you have really block diagonal tensor. This is a simple symmetric block diagonal tensor with only the even sector. And this is also a symmetric tensor, but with very specific blocks. Only
this would
two
be block diagonal too, sort of.
Yeah, it's only also block diagonal, so
right.
That's what I was trying to say. It's also block diagonal, so all the charges are given by double charges, Q prime beta Q prime, Q second gamma, but on the top of that you have this delta function that tells you that the charges should be the same on all legs. So you only have very specific blocks. So here you could have had a lot of blocks, right? But you select only very specific blocks. Only, in this case, two blocks, 0, 0, 0, and 1, 1, 1.
Okay? Right, for each physical state, only one of the blocks is non-zero in the respective input.
Yes, indeed. So exactly. If you put here 0, then you would get just this matrix here.
Matrix in the 0, 0 block?
Yes, in the 0, 0 block, there is a matrix. And if you put 1, you would get only a direct sum matrix, so they act on orthogonal pieces of the Hilbert space on the auxiliary level, right? And so what I wanted to say that's where the... So you could ask yourself, why do I bother to do all these calculation, if you want, theoretical construction, if I just can minimize the Hamiltonian, and I know the gauge symmetry is stable, and I should get a gauge invariant state. The answer is exactly this one, because you can reduce the computational cost a lot. And when you go to groups like SU3, where the irreducible representation is quite large, and you have to take several, I didn't get into the detail, but you can read into the paper that if you want to get a non-trivial gauge theory for other group, you need to take more than one irreducible representation. Similar to what Norbert said about the singlet state, you remember it took 1 plus the fundamental representation. It's very similar here. Then you start to have very large. So if you construct the full tensor here, you have a very large bond dimension, and then it's very difficult to perform a calculation. Right? In this way, not only you are guaranteed that your approximation will not support gauge invariance, that maybe you can say, as I argued at the beginning of the talk, that that's not a real problem. But on the other hand, you're also sure that you optimize the number of variational parameters so that you only describe that section of the Hilbert space. It is still exponentially large, but it's a bit smaller than the full Hilbert space. Okay, so that's, yes?
I understand. Your construction does not matter whether it is confining or deconfining.
Indeed.
Do you think to simulate the confining phase?
So yeah, the confined phase is just simply if you here put a projector onto plus,
yeah.
So the product state, you will see that this so for example this simple stuff here would get you the projector onto plus.
But if we put the two some electric charge, then the energy it depends on the
separation. Yes. So I didn't discuss the case in which you also have matter. But it's a trivial generalization of this idea here. But you can see that you can indeed the confining phase is typically easier to simulate than the deconfined phase. Then I could agree that at some stage maybe in the confined phase, I'm not sure if this. So you still, what I mean is that you still use this sparse structure here. But you could really go to the direct sum of irreducible representation, and since the irreducible representation are weighted in the Hamiltonian, I didn't arrive to that, but this electric part gives a specific energy to each irreducible representation, and so there you can really project everything, and maybe there is a smarter way to do it, so you don't really need to keep all the things, and you can work with the standard PEPs in one representation. But as soon as you have to use more than one representation, I think that this is the best possible computational strategy.
So if I have a Hamiltonian with some global symmetry,
mm-hmm.
does using this way, can I just gauge in the theory?
Yeah, so indeed.
But I still need to construct this local symmetry operator.
Yeah, so the point is that's, I think, this strategy is described in the paper by Frank, Uto, and other people. So you can, I kind of started with the local symmetry, but you can ask yourself, if I have a wave function that is already global symmetry, how do I gauge the wave function? And it turns out that you can do very similar strategy to gauge a wave function with global symmetry, and you would get, now you should use this U that I described, in very, very specific way, and you would get that maybe this is your, if you want, this is your PEPs with global symmetry. and so on. And now with you using this U, you can extend it to some top layer that takes care of the, if you want, of the links also. And so you get a double layer structure that in some case can be merged down again to a single layer structure with using this U and the algebraic properties. But in principle, you should take a double layer thing. But for sure, these data are also globally invariant because if you combine all the local symmetry, you get the global symmetry, right? And since they are invariant under local symmetry, they are also invariant under global symmetries.
Yes. So you worked out the exact form, for example, for the toroidal ground state?
Yes, for the toroidal ground state is exactly what I told you. So just the copy tensor and this selection of all the possible allowed stuff, you get the linear superposition of all the things. This is an alternative representation of the toroidal wave function, if you want, with respect to the one that discussed Norbert, no? And indeed, you can also, so the interesting thing is that that's exactly what we did. So you can also go from a U1 theory to a Z2 theory, and by just changing some parameters of this wave function and go to a U1 liquid, and you really see, when you measure the topological entropy, you really see a kind of kink from the Z2 value to the U1 value. So you can compute the topological entropy, put these ansatz on the torus, compute the on the cylinder, compute the topological entropy, and you really get the kink from one side to the other of the transition.
How long could it chew from G2 to U1?
So, it takes me 5 minutes to explain. So basically, the idea is that if you have U1, now your loop is given by a phase. Instead of just plus or minus one, you have all possible points on your circle. Now a possible representation of this is just taking two irreducible representations. Again, this is an abelian group, all irreducible representations are one-dimensional. You can take two of them and define a rotation by the element, let's say alpha, as plus e to the alpha minus minus. So it's very simple generalization with respect to the Z2 case, where here we have the minus, right? Here we have an I alpha. But now if you construct the same symmetry operator that acts on four links, right? And now you have to be careful which enters and which exit, and you want the symmetry operator to be one, right? So if here it enters, so I use the same notation where if you want, this is a plus is this and minus is this, okay? So if minus enters here, I mean that I pick up an e to the I alpha, it should exit from one of the two directions that I have here. That is, it means that it cannot go here, for example. And so I get this possible configuration, I get this possible configuration, I get these two possible configuration, and then I get, so let me complete it, I should get six, because I can get still this possible configuration here, and I miss one, the vertical one, right? This, and all white, right? So instead of having eight possible configuration, now I only have six possible configuration. And so, as I told you, this vertex tensor here selects all the allowed gauge invariant configuration, and so by changing from a tensor that selects eight possible configuration to one that selects only six, so changing some of my parameters of the tensor from 0 to 1, basically, I will go from a Z2 invariant state to a U1 invariant state. And that's a bit a wave function deformation. Okay, so this is called the six vertex model. So what I mean is that it's called the six vertex model in the sense that the overlap of my wave function describe the partition function of the six vertex model, but in the other case, in the Z2 case or the toricot case, the overlap of my wave function describe the partition function of the eight vertex model. Okay, and so it was already known by the times of Baxter that you can make a transition from the six vertex to the eight vertex by changing the weights of the vertex, and that's exactly what it's doing. So I'm changing the weight of the vertex by changing the wave function. And the six vertex model is critical, and it is a U1 liquid, if you want. You have these kind of strings that can only turn in one direction. Okay?